וזה גולי וידיע לפני מי שום עבורי אוילם. אוסם הדרגה שאין בדרך שמייק כמו אוסם. So we spoke about last time, the madrega that's called מי שום עבורי אוילם. מי שום עבורי אוילם is the origin from where everything manifested. So the origin of life, before life became the way that we know it, there was existence, like it says that the name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu was with him, Kishalhevez Kishura Begacheles, just like a flame is tied to the coal, which means that it's within the coal and it's one with the coal. The same way the name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which is the name of existence, was tied to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It was intrinsic within him that he was existent, but there was nothing to demonstrate that existence to. So there wasn't really a name. A name manifests when there's somebody that can correspond to that information and say, okay, now I know what we're talking about. So that's the purpose of a name. So before there was creation, the name was within the Creator. The existence was within the Creator and it was united with him. And then came from Misha Omar V'Hoi Olam, from that point, started manifesting all kinds of realities. And all these realities are from and within the Creator that he is manifesting. Just like a person manifests a thought, and then the thought is within and united with the person that's thinking it. The same way HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the creation came forth, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu is united with that creation. So that level that we refer to, Misha Omar V'Hoi Olam, that silence, that ayin that we can relate to, which is not ayin, it's the potential of all the yesh, it's what powers all the yesh, but regarding our word, our vocabulary, our world of words, we call it ayin. From that space, Reb Meir could be masik. So therefore it says, goli v'yedia lifnei oisa madrege, for that level, she'ein b'dayri she Reb Meir kamoise, there's nobody else in Reb Meir's generation that understands like Reb Meir does, b'madrege zu. V'gam Rebbe, Rabbeinu HaKadosh came after Reb Meir. Rabbeinu HaKadosh was the end of the Tanoim, and that's why he collected the Mishnah, which had all the different statements that were made by the Tanoim, starting from the Zugois, from the beginning of the time of the Tanoim, from Shimon HaTzadik, who was the first Tana after the Anshei Knesset HaGdoyle, going down all the way to Rabbeinu HaKadosh, the last Tana. So Rabbeinu HaKadosh collected all that wisdom. So Gam Rebbe Hisik Tzas Mimadrega Zu. So he was able to be masig a little portion of this madrega, meaning he also had access to this resha de lo isyada. He didn't know exactly how to bring everything back to that place, but he had some glimpse of Reb Meir, meaning he had some of the understanding that that's where everything ends up. The reason that I'm sharper than my friends, Rebbe said, is because I saw Reb Meir's back. I saw his back, I didn't see his face. So what does it mean? Perish aderech moshul kinyin v'risas achoyrai ein berambam perikala misoyed atoyed retzolem asogish ayinu mevredes. So when Moshe Rabbeinu saw the achorayim of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says v'risas achoyrai fonai lo yirui, so he saw the asoga that he was trying to see, but it wasn't clear to him. And that means seeing the achorayim. Just like when you see a person from behind, you're not sure that it's him. It might be him, it might not be him, you might easily make a mistake. The same way when you see an understanding from the Bechinas Acharayim, you recognize it, but you don't fully know it. So the same thing Rebbe is saying, I saw Reb Meir Me'achoyrav, meaning I understood what Reb Meir was teaching, but not fully, not to the depth that Reb Meir understood it. So when you say Re'isa is Reb Meir, it means that he understood, that he was able to see with the mind, with the eye of his perception, to understand. So what's visible to the mind is called the ear, like he brings on the posik, V'libi roa har b'chochma, Shlem HaMelech says, my heart saw. So the heart sees through perception. And that's the ikar vision. The ikar vision is the pnimizdik vision. The external vision is just a meshoris, it's a meshamish, so that the internal vision can see and understand, can explore life. For us, it becomes, because we're so used to seeing and identifying with what we see, the external eyes, sometimes we use them in place of the internal eyes, meaning we don't really understand our experience, but we think that what we're looking at is our experience. And that's simply not true, because the moment you close your eyes, you are still the same you that you were when your eyes were open, even though it feels very different. So the you that lives inside, you have a better chance of seeing him when your eyes are closed. Because when your eyes are closed, you don't identify with anything else. So you visualize the self as the being that lives inside your body, not the one that's seeing or hearing or talking. Those are all additional functions that you can use yourself for. But even a person who is blind is still himself. A person who is deaf is still himself, which means that you are not those things. We're not any of those things. So those things are there to serve the self. When we open our eyes and we consider ourselves to be the things that we're seeing, we get ourselves into more difficult areas, because what we're seeing is not necessarily easy for us to digest. What's inside of us, if it's clean, when it's elekayne shomer shenasat to be tohoruhi, then it's easy. It's natural for us to perceive it and to accept it and to enjoy its presence. But what's going on outside of us, it could be painful sometimes. We could see things that we don't know how to digest. So that's why it's important to realize the real re'iyah is internal. The real shmiyah is internal, like the pasuk says, lev shemea. The real functions of all our chushim, of all our senses, are internal. The external chushim teach us about the internal. They teach us how we function inside. And beyond that, even if we look at the physical side of our chushim, of our senses, it's not the sense that's actually being experienced. So for example, a person feels a smell, he feels it through his nose. His nose is the one that's sending the vibrations to the mind. But the experience of smell is already within your mind as a potential, meaning your spirit has the capability of distinguishing between different smells and knowing the difference and appreciating it. So when you use your physical sensors, which are in your nose, your mind can translate that. If your mind didn't have the software to do it, the physical nose wouldn't be able to give it smell. So the physical nose is just an extension of the mind, allowing you to translate whatever is going on in the air into something we consider smell. And the same thing, the eyes and the ears, everything that you're experiencing internally in the mind. The eyes are not your sight. Your sight is your potential to be able to convert data that comes in through your eyes and convert that into an image within your mind. It's your mind that can see, it's your spirit that sees. Your eyes are simply tools. They're just physical extensions that allow you to convert data in a language that your spirit can understand. And therefore, everything that's really happening to you is happening inside. And this is extremely important, because inside, you're the boss. You're the owner. You're the one running the show. So when we forget that, when we think that our eyes see and that's the end of the process, we don't recognize that it's the spirit that sees, that's the spirit that smells, the spirit that hears, then the information that we see and we hear can bind us, can cause bondage, where we afterwards we're left traumatized, or we're left wanting or desiring, or all these different things, because we identified within something that's not us. And now we are bound with that idea as if it's us. It came into our heichel, into our place of, into our humble abode, inside our brain, and it's bothering us in there, inside our home. So, and this can only happen when you allow it in. How do we allow it in? By identifying with something that's not you as if it's you. And then you're offending the actual one that's living in there, because he is not appreciating this thought. He's not appreciating the bondage. He's not appreciating the lack of freedom that was designated to him as a result of something that wasn't even under your control in the first place. Something that somebody else said, something that somebody else did. And that bondage is now within, it's now real. So all bondage happens from pain and pleasure. Pain and pleasure cause us to have bondage to and from different things. And it can get very complicated for us to figure ourselves out afterwards. But the ultimate goal of the Torah is to take us out of Mitzrayim. Yetzias Mitzrayim means leaving the bondage. Leaving your connection that is driving you to different things that are external, and recognizing that your true source has no bondage and it's inside of you. It's the potential to be all the things, and it has to remain that. It has to remain the potential to be all things. As soon as you have pain or pleasure that lock it into a specific type of way it wants to be, now there's going to be a result of fear. There's going to be a result of wanting and desires, and all this moves our peace away to a future state where we say, when I'll get this and when I'll have that, I'll allow myself to release myself from the bondage. And that's just pushing away what's extremely necessary for you right now. We all need peace in every single moment because that's when we are free. That's when we have the ability to remain healthy. As soon as we start going off on different things, on different feelings and desires that are not healthy, we lose our peace of mind. We're holding our brain in an unhealthy position. And as long as we hold our brain in an unhealthy position, it's not interacting with our body in a healthy way. It's not giving us the sustenance that we need. So that's why we talk about the internal being. So this internal being, when it's properly understood, has an origin, has a source of where it started all its bondage, where it started, where all the complications started. And this also happens in the bigger scheme of things, where we see the pasuk says in Parshas Hazinu, Zechor Yimoy Soilam Binu Shnois Doi V'Doi. Remember the days of the world and understand the years and the changes of every generation. Why is this important? Because this is who we are. Why are we in this mess? If you ask yourself, why is life the way that it is? Why are things so complicated? Because we didn't come at the beginning of the story. People have made life extremely complicated, generation after generation after generation, deeper and deeper. And every generation that came to fix something, we need to understand what were they fixing and how were they fixing it? And was the fix a permanent fix where it needs to remain this way for the rest of eternity? Or maybe the fix was temporary, so we need to now balance something and then we have to come back to center. So a lot of the things, a lot of the exodus, a lot of the different types of behaviors that came that came into being throughout our history, a lot of it was done by Chachomim that understood what they were doing and they actually made changes that helped humanity. And a lot of it was done by other nations, a lot of it was done by people who didn't fully understand, and a lot of things need to be undone. So that's why Pasuk says, Zechor Yimoy Yisraelam, Binu Shnois Doi V'Doi, Sh'al Avicha V'Yagetcha Zekenecha V'Yom R'loch, Bahanchel El Yon Goyim, Bafride Bnei Adam, which is by the door of Logo, right? When HaKadosh Baruch Hu separated Hanchel El Yon Goyim, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu was ready to give nations to these people, all the different people that were there at the door of Logo, the 70 nations came out of them. Bafride Bnei Adam, he separated the people into separate groups. Yatziv Gevilas Amim Lemispa Bnei Yisrael. So all the Amim were separated to be in accordance with the Shivim Nefesh of the Bnei Yisrael that went into Mitzrayim. So one correlates to the other. So Klal Yisrael goes into Mitzrayim in order to go into the bondage, in order to be able to separate the truth from the bondage and to be able to go out and to lead all the nations out of this bondage, lead all nations out of the realities that they've created with their languages. Because all the realities created by the 70 languages are false. All language at its essence is bondage. That's why we see in the Sefer Chanoich that the Malochim that taught people how to write words and letters and create concept, that was considered a bad maneuver by these Malochim. The Kadosh Baruch Hu wasn't happy with that because this was the beginning of people manipulating each other, of people creating concepts and ideas within each other that are not real, but the purpose of which is to control one another. So to go back to this Cheirus, to go back to this infinite light that is the source of all manifestation, the Misha Omar V'Hoyo Oilam, that Reb Meir knew how to do and Rebbe saw from him, and Rebbe learned from him how to do it. So therefore, he's saying that the Re'iyah is a soga, k'me v'libri ar b'chochme, v'chein kavon eskro, the Re'iyah enecha rois esmerecho, the ma'aser etzolem re'en ha'seichel. That when a person, enecha rois esmerecho, means that you're going to recognize who is teaching you. So when HaKadosh Baruch Hu is nizgalat us, we're going to recognize that he's the melame toira lam Yisrael, when Mashiach comes, v'hoi enecha rois esmerecho. So it means the ene ha'seichel, that the ene ha'seichel will recognize from where they receive seichel. So when you receive a realization, you won't be only the one that received the realization, you will also recognize that something inside of you gave you that realization. You also came up with it. You came up with it, one part of you came up with it, the unconscious part, and it delivered it to the conscious side of you. So there's the two sides, there's the giving and the receiving in every realization. The one that's giving ultimately is HaKadosh Baruch Hu, is the seichel from reality that knows the truth. Because the seichel that created life knows the truth. The seichel that created your body knows its truth. It knows how to create a body, and it lives inside of you, that seichel. but your access to that seichel is hindered, is limited. And that's based on behavior, it's based on beliefs, it's based on understandings, it's based on emotions, that we lose access to the seichel that creates us and the seichel that allows us to think. So when our energy is low, when our spiritual energy is low, we don't have access to our own seichel. Things that were clear to us, that we understood at a certain point in time, in a time when our energy is low, we don't understand it. We don't see it for that. We can't recognize it. It's not. It doesn't feel alive. It doesn't feel real. Because the language with our own seichel, the connection, the access that we have with our spiritual root has been tampered with, has been weakened. And that's through beliefs. That's through emotions. That's through activities that are not within accordance with our beliefs, that are not within accordance of our moral understandings. And when we violate that, we lose access to our own seichel. We lose access to our own ability to manifest our true self. So when the time comes, that your eyes, your enei seichel, will recognize where its own seichel comes from, you will see how imminent the Kedusha of HaKadosh Baruch Hu is, how imminent the Chochmah of HaKadosh Baruch Hu is, that it's literally the one that's feeding you every single thought. Without his Chochmah, you wouldn't know what to make, how to create your next thought. So that formula that creates your thoughts, that's from him. That's HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself that created that and put and placed that inside of you. So, therefore, because Rabbi had an understanding of Rabbi Meir's Torah, even though it was only Ma'achoyrov, he didn't really fully understand it, but still, all the Stam Mishnas are Rabbi Meir, meaning that when Rabbi was writing down the Mishnayos as a Mesoret to the future generations, he already paskened like Rabbi Meir because he understood that Rabbi Meir is deeper than the rest of the Chachomim. And therefore, Stam Mishne Rabbi Meir, that Rabbi was soisim the Mishnah. He didn't say who it is, and that's a sign that we paskin like that, in order for us to paskin according to Rabbi Meir, because that is how Rabbi understood the truth. That's what Rabbi understood is real. V'ayim b'shili hoyri is the Rabbi that asked the Rabbi Meir, loymer Rabbi Meir v'la achayrim, v'amru miyem shememem when he shows him. So Rabbi Meir, because he learned from Elisha ben Avi, and Chazal weren't happy with that, they called him Acherim sometimes. And Rabbi was the one who said that we shouldn't be calling him Acherim because the Torah that we're learning, we're drinking his water and we're mezalzel in his Torah. So therefore, Rabbi was the one that took Reb Meir out from that and made us call him Reb Meir, like he was originally. Even though his name was Reb Noirai. Reb Noirai is in Aramit, it means Reb Meir. But Chazal said the reason they called him Reb Meir, Shemeir Eini Chachomim Ba'alocha. That because he was Meir Eini Chachomim Ba'alocha, they called him in Beloshna Kodesh Meir, which is a stronger light. Noirai is the Achoraim, is the tzad of the light that you see from the Achoraim of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's also called light, Noirai. But Meir is Loshna Kodesh light. Loshna Kodesh is the Pnimius of the Chochmah, that Reb Meir had access even to the Pnimius HaChochmah, to a place where you get to the Mishom of Ahoy Olam, that by him there can be no evil. Everything that is has a perfect explanation. And this relates to understanding generations. Understanding how we got ourselves into this trouble is the answer to the trouble. Why did we have the Mabul? How were people behaving prior to the Mabul? What were the Gzeres that were done after the Mabul? How were people behaving before in Mitzrayim? How are people behaving after Mitzrayim? What happened by the Lichas Rishonis? Why did we need a Lichas Shnias? What happened when they went into Mitzrayim? What happened by the Charbonis of the Bayis? What were the Gezeres that Chazal had to make because of the Charbonis of the Bayis and how they happened? What happened by the Bayis Sheini? All this is the reason why we are the way that we are. It's the reason that our Torah evolved into so much detail and created so much Gedorim, Yogim, and all kinds of different Chochmas and different ideas of correcting what's wrong with humanity. How did we get into this place? Zohar Yemoy Soilam, look at the history and you'll see that everything came at a certain time, at a certain place to correct a certain problem. When we will understand all these problems, we'll be able to unravel this whole history that we went deeper and deeper and deeper away from our nature. But each time we went deeper away from our nature, it was to fix something where we were not with our nature that needed fixing. Something had, some gezeira had to be made so that people can start shifting into a different area and change their understanding so that we can go eventually back to our nature, so that we can recognize our nature at the end of all of this. So the real explanation is the reality of how it happened. The reality of how it happened is the explanation. That's always in Ruchnius. There's never anything outside or external that we're trying to bring to an equation in order to fix it. There's nothing external that can ever help an equation. The only understanding we look for is the internal understanding of how did problems occur within this experience, and then we can unravel that. Because the natural state, as we always believe, as we always come back to, is the state of the yichud, is a state where there's no problems. So whenever there's a problem, we're going to unravel, we're going to go back and look at the roots of the problem and see how did we get ourselves into this mess? What caused it? And sometimes one mess leads to another mess, leads to another mess, leads to another mess. And this is how the Golias happened. If not for Golias Mitzrayim, we wouldn't be able to be in any Golias. Mitzrayim was the mother of all Golias. And because Klal Yisrael never really left Mitzrayim, because even though they left, they weren't able to be mekabel the lichas rishonis. They died, and then they asked Moshe to be the interpreter, and then they had the chet ha'egel, which means they never really, their consciousness, their spirit, never really left Mitzrayim. That made all the other Golias afterwards possible. So one comes in front of the other. So Golias Bavel wouldn't be if not for Golias Mitzrayim. But now that we're in Golias Bavel, Golias Poras becomes possible. Now that we believe in Poras, now Golias Yovan becomes possible. Now that we go through Golias Yovan, Golias Edom and Yishmol become possible. But they all become possible, they all go deeper and deeper, further and further away from the source, further and further away from our nature, from the reality of a human being and how he really works. And one becomes possible because previously there was a problem, a misunderstanding. That misunderstanding opens up the door to other misunderstandings, and so it goes. So we go deeper and deeper into illusion. And these are the levels of illusion, like the Torah starts off with. So say Chazal, Tov, this is Golias Bavel. Ibo is Golias Poras. And V'choshech is Golias Yovan. And Tohoim is the Golias of Edom and Yishmol, where we are now, which is the Tohoim, it's the abyss. It's just free-falling into a reality that has no support for you whatsoever. You have no value here. You're just a part of the system. If you die, somebody will replace you, no big deal. That's how deep the abyss is, that everything else, concepts, ideas, and structures have become so important that the human being is just the slave that's falling under all that pressure, and nobody's even looking out for him. That's the extreme opposite of the original, where HaKadosh Baruch Hu created Adam Arisha and Ani Amarti Alehim Atem, that you're perfect, you're the divine being, everything is here to serve you. So we went from that extreme, Igri Roma Lebir Amikta, to all the way the opposite. You are worth nothing. Everything is more important than you. And this is where we've landed today. So this, from this place, from where we are, it seems very distant, these understandings of Remeir, of how you make this all good. But by understanding how we traveled and how we got here, we see that each time, by trying to make things better and by trying to avoid certain mistakes, we just perpetuated into this mess, slowly. So he's saying that the Rebbe holds that the day of Yom Kippur is mechaper, even if a person doesn't do tshuva. The fact that Yom Kippur passed, even if the person was not mechaven to anything, that alone is mechaper. And the Rebbe could believe that because of his understanding of Reb Meir, because he knows that there's a place where there's a yichud, where it's ati atcher nivro elam ati mishnivro elam, when it's the same. So therefore, the day itself, just by coming, that recognition of that day, that realization of what really is happening here, that alone brings a person back to his original source, to his original place, even though he himself didn't understand it. It comes through the unconscious. It doesn't have to be conscious. That's what Rebbe holds. And that goes according to the pasuk, v'chanoises ha'shirochem v'chantis ha'shirachem, like we know, the tzaddikim are always asking from HaKadosh Baruch Hu matnas chinam. Why are they asking matnas chinam? Because mi yitzdak lefon of badin. If you go v'midas sadin to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, nobody's ever going to win. And this is why we have all the dinim spelled out for us. Chazal spelled out for us dinim upon dinim upon dinim, and they said, you want to live by the midas sadin? Here, go learn all this. Kufalem har kegigis. the Midas Adin is no way to survive. The Midas HaChesed is a place where a person can get for free. And over there, Moshe Rabbeinu and you are the same level. And if Rebbeinu Shlomo wants to give you, he'll give you. He'll give you because he wants to give. And Moshe Rabbeinu himself didn't want to go to the other door. He didn't want to go to the door where he say, you see how good I am, give me. Moshe Rabbeinu himself would only knock at the door that says, give me for free. The same door where you have access to, we all have access to. The difference is that Moshe Rabbeinu knew that he has access to it. We're not so sure. When we're not sure, we end up at the other door. And the other door nobody wants to knock on. Give me because I deserve. Who can say those words? But thank God that he's not like that. It's that if a person asks, a person humbles himself, a person realizes that this is not his show, this is HaKadosh Baruch Hu's show. And because it's HaKadosh Baruch Hu's show, it should be a nice show. Nobody should be suffering. And therefore, when he comes and asks HaKadosh Baruch Hu for Chanina, Mitzad, the Chesed of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Chesed of HaKadosh Baruch Hu is Mo'olam Va'adolam Al Yireh, it has no gvul, it has no limit. It can remove a person from all of his problems. Even though from his cheshbonos it seems like he deserves it, from other people's cheshbonos it seems like he deserves it, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu has different cheshbonos. HaKadosh Baruch Hu's cheshbonos we don't know. So we ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu for Chanina, we say, even if your cheshbonos say we need to suffer, we still beg you, please don't make us suffer. So that, the Rebbe had access to that window. And therefore he said that Yom Kippur is mechaper, even l'sheinam shuvim. It's a kapara that comes from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, has nothing to do with the person. And therefore, this place, the asar, the lo kaima l'shaila, you can't ask any questions of it, because like we said, it's the reisha de lo yisida, the hayomi, the kegurim, loyder achdis agmura, it's moyder the yichud in such a way, achdis agmura iglu alefen aniskar, Delechein, oy kohen godel hoyga Hashem boy beyom da Hashem avay vagiusim moir al yichud agomis. He said, why did the kohen godel say HaKadosh Baruch Hu's name on that day out of all the other days? It's because that day represents HaKadosh Baruch Hu's name expressed. That the Shem HaFoyrish comes out, Meforish Yotzim Epi kohen godel, that energy reflects the energy of the day. And what's that energy? It's the energy of avay. It's the recognition that everything that exists is nevea from the Mekora Avaya, and it's never separate from it. It cannot be separated, regardless of what takes place. So even though this reality had to be hidden from the people, why did it have to be hidden from the people? Look back at the days before the Mabul, look how people behaved, look what was going on this planet, and you'll know why this reality had to be hidden. However, one day in the year, we still get this. We still get access to this energy where we can cleanse ourselves, like Rabbi Akiva says, "Ma'amik v'metaris atmai, ma'afakadosh baruch hu metaris yisrael." So just like the mikveh is metar begashmi, berochni, this Shem Avaya coming out, meforish yotzim pin godol, used to turn over the chitashoni to become white, right? Kasheleg yalbino, because it's the recognition that what was created originally, everything that emanates from the eternal source has to be pure. There's no other option. So even though now in its current state it doesn't seem that way, eventually we will know it for what it is. Commotion is by Lamala. He didn't see the pnimius of Reb Meir, he didn't see his face. Meaning, according to Reb Meir, if we had access to Reb Meir's Torah, it would be Yom Kippur every day. But the Rebbe only saw Me'achoyrov. Me'achoyrov, he saw that one day a year we could do this. One day a year at least, we can be Moichel even L'Shein HaShovim. V'hinei Alocha Enokein. But we don't paskin like that, like Rebbe, that Yom Kippur is B'chapi L'Shein HaShovim. V'lo nikva Alocha Kemoisoi, fi shebri Yisoi L'moisoi B'geder Yigvil, Yimokim L'bchira B'toi V'ra Eschar V'oynish. So this world, this Halam that was created by the Torah, but was created with words, was created in order to hide HaKadosh Baruch Hu's reality. These words were not created to show them to you right away. These words were created originally to hide, and then you have to go looking, and then if you want it enough, you can find it within this text. We could have given it another text. We could have given it in a text where it's megale everything. It just tells you the truth the way that it is. But that's not what Moshe Rabbeinu chose to give you. Why did he not choose to give you that? Look at the history. Look at the people. Look who he was dealing with. Understand. understand the difference between people then and people now. Then, when the Torah was given, people were homicidal. If they didn't like something, they killed other people. This was a known occurrence. Even Chur was from a very, very chosh of a family. He wasn't just some guy that nobody would notice missing. And they killed him. Even Aharon was afraid to be decapitated by these fellas. We were dealing with very high caliber spirits that were ready to go all out based on their beliefs and understandings. So we're dealing with the homicidal crowd. You need text that can somehow control these people. Let's not even talk about the wise ones amongst them who want to be good. Let's talk about the low ones amongst them. What's going to hold them in place? So this text has to do all of that. Today, we're dealing with people who are suicidal. It's a very, very different strain. It's a very, very different type of being, and it needs a very, very different language. And that's what the Baal Shem Tov was saying. Today's people, if you speak to them in a difficult language, if they listen to you, they're even worse off than if they don't listen to you. Because the soul is so damaged, the spirit is so weak, that one bad sentence, one bad statement can ruin a person's trajectory. It could take away all his potential. Because we're very frustrated as is with our reality. And therefore, the Torah needs to be kulo chesed. The Torah needs to be nizgale, where the nistar comes out, the chelik nistar. What's the chelik nistar? Toichai rotzef ahava. That inside of the difficult words of the Torah is hidden a tremendous love. And the reason the Torah had to dress up in an angry tone in order to give this love, like the Medrash says that we see by Ve'elah Mishpatim, that right after Matan Torah, right after Yisra comes Ve'elah Mishpatim, so it says, Divrei Torah comes Zayin Lefaneh Ve'Zayin L'Achreh. There's always guards, armed guards, standing before the Torah and after the Torah. Before the Torah was by Shabbos, and where they were taught Shabbos and Moro, where it says they were taught Dinim and Shabbos, and that was the Dinim, that was the Zayin Lefaneh, that was the army that comes to protect the Torah before it's Nizgala, before HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, Anoich Hashem Elokecho. These are the dinim that come after the Torah to protect the Torah. And all this because the Torah is such a powerful message, the truth is so powerful, that if the Torah won't make it completely difficult, won't make it hard to see through, and everybody will be able to see through, then the ones that we're trying to take away the koyach from are going to become powerful by it. Like it was before the Mabul, where everybody had chokhm, everybody had power, and they couldn't be contained by words. But after the Mabul, their power was taken away, and their bondage with words became much deeper. The 70 languages were created, and all the different fake societies came up where people can just hallucinate together what they think is important in life. And this allowed us to lose our divine identity. And why is this good? It's good because while we had our divine identity, we weren't sharing it appropriately, we weren't uniting like the intention was. So once it's taken away, people suffer. People get broken. Then they say, give me some wisdom and I'll follow it. I'll do whatever you want. Just make me stop suffering. So everything has a purpose and everything has a plan. And there's a reason why we've arrived to this place. There's a reason why we have devolved so far. And the people who set us up were experts at human nature, at the divine human nature, at the subtle human nature of that spirit that lives inside each one of us, and they knew how to play with it. They knew how to motivate it. They knew how to limit it. They knew how to give it power. They understood in each sentence, in each word, what's the message behind, what's the energy that's going to be created in the brain that receives these words. How is that going to actually translate into his life? However, it's a very subtle and it's a very deep message. So the generations that don't have access to the subtlety and to the depth, they can make that message extremely painful. And all of us in the Goliaths that are next to the Christians, where the Christians took religion into an extremely, extremely painful place, into an extremely angry place. So all of us suffer from, because the subtle, deep meaning of the Torah has been tainted, has been lost. This could only happen like I said before, after Yavan. But Yavan made it intellectual, so first we don't feel what's happening, it's just words, it's just up in the brain. Now Adam can come and twist those words and make us fear and cause the actual experience to be horrible. But why don't we notice? How can we get into such a place? Because Yavan has already neutralized our feelings. When we accept the words, we don't even feel what they mean. It's not an experience, it's just an intellectual concept. So we think, okay, it could be like this, it could be like that. But when it plays out, when we try to live in accordance with those beliefs, it becomes extremely painful. Certain areas in your life that need more development are not being developed. Certain areas of your life that you want to stay away from, and they're right in the center of the whole culture. So these things are because people who don't understand humans have set us up like that. And this has to do with not understanding the true meaning, the chokhmah of the Torah, which goes very, very deep. And then the words can take on any meaning. Any person could find meaning within words. That's not the true essence of the Torah. That never was the true intention of the Torah, and it never will be. Because if so, the goyim could learn it just like us. What difference would there be? We know the difference is in our midas, in our heart, because that's the source of the interpretation. The interpretation of the words starts within the heart. When the heart's in the right place, the words get interpreted appropriately. When the heart's in the wrong place, you can see by the Christians what they did with a religion that was supposedly based only on love. Forget all the mitzvahs, forget all the pratim, just be love. An inquisition. Same words. The same words. But the hearts are missing. Shadim learning Torah. And that's extremely dangerous. That's where we have all these interpretations that cause damage to the human fiber, to the spirit that wants to live, that wants to be here. And once that's damaged, then the actions and the words cannot be appropriate. It cannot, because it doesn't have the subtlety, it doesn't have the feeling, the emotion that attaches the mind to life, that makes the mind love life, love humans, love what it is for itself. When the mind doesn't love what it is, it's not going to love all the others that are the same way. It's just at war with its own kind. So this is at the very essence of the Torah is the Golius. That's why it starts. Bereshis Bore Elikim, Es Hashemayim Ves Haaretz Va'aretz Ois Hatohu. You're starting to learn. Let me tell you something. Your brain is in the dumps. So be very careful when you learn. Be careful what you give meaning to what words and how they're going to affect you. Va'aretz Ois Hatohu V'voy V'choshech Al Pnei Hatohu. First pasuk. Don't go any further before you realize that your brain is not reliable. Your brain has four different clippers covering it. Every thought that's going to be coming from that brain, even though you're interpreting the words of my Torah, says Moshe, it's not me. It's not me talking. That's the Tohu, V'Vohu, V'Choshech, Apnei Tohu. That's what's talking in you. When you manage to clean yourself out a little bit from that, then you can start looking at my Torah and it will start making sense to you. Then you can actually gain something from it. So it says, the halacha wasn't like that because people are not ready for that. So the halacha always goes according to the level of the people. The more din that's in within the people, the more the halacha needs to be al pi midas hadin, so that we reflect the actual behavior of the people. Because if we're going to paskin more b'midas ha-chesed than the people are ready to handle, then it's going to result in hefkeres, and the people are not going to be able to grow because their midas hadin is not going to be contained. So they're going to continue fighting. So the dinim are here to contain the midas adin, and they contain the midas adin to the extent that it's necessary, to the extent that generation needs it to be contained. That's why we see as Klal Yisrael goes into galus, the gzeiris, the siyogim, and the dinim keep going up and up and up. Why? Because the dinim of the people is going up. They're being tortured. So there's going to be more dinim in the people, there's going to be more dinim in the Torah. If we would only have Chamishachim She Torah and the first Sefer Yeshua, that would have been enough. The rest we would be able to understand from our own spirits, from our own understanding. Why did we need this continuance that continues with no end? Because we went deeper and deeper and deeper into Dinim, into the Midas Adin. We're exploring the Midas Adin in great detail so that we can afterwards contain it and we can be in charge of it so that it doesn't fight with humanity, it helps humanity, it protects humanity. That's what it's there for. So v'zeh shomu l'Rabbi Yishmol, k'saf sh'yuchel limchiz b'inam, d'tzurich sh'yeh afshorius, limchiz v'kil kla k'saf, d'hayin v'chida b'ra, v'shiyeh mokim gam l'ra li motzei. So going back to Rabbi Yishmol, was a sofer, that he would write the Sifrei Torah, and it needs to be a k'saf that you can erase, meaning that you write the Torah and it doesn't always go as it's necessary. We're not yet at a place of a Gula Shlema where everything works the way that it is and all the parts come together where there's no, where it's Bila Moves Lenetzach, like we're going to get to when Mashiach comes. And therefore, there has to be the possibility of erasing, which shows the ability for Ra to manifest. Because when somebody is lacking certain psukim in the Torah, he's also going into areas of illusion, he's going into areas of evil. Shazem Adrega said, Mazekfi Mashug, Hagam, the Boilam Abo Ensham Mechirik, Masham Rizal, Ayoim La Soysim Loilam Mochor, that when Mashiach comes, when there's, then there's ultimately the Olam Abo, there's no place for Asiyas HaMitzvahs, Masham Rizal. And commandoma mitzvahs betailis losid lovoi. There's a mandoma that says that mitzvahs are bot losid lovoi, and there's a lot of machlokes in the Rishonim when this happens. If it's right away when Mashiach comes, or after Tchias HaMesim, but hakol moedim, that in 220 years from now, when it comes the Elef HaShvi, that the mitzvahs are betailis. We won't be doing the mitzvahs lemaise. We're going to be doing them besichlis, just like they did, just like the Ovis did before Matan Torah, so too. After the when the Elef HaShvi comes and it's Yom Shekilei Shabbos, then it's not Hayom LaSoysam VeLoy Mochar LaSoysam, because Mochar you won't get any schar for doing a mitzvah, because you're going to want to do it based on the reality that you know you're not going to have any mitzvah to do it. Adarav, the one that you have mitzvahs for, the one that we're trying to protect, will be awake and you'll ask him what he wants you to do. He'll know. So therefore, when Mashiach comes or later at a certain point. The mitzvahs maisis are not going to apply the way that they do now. And there's definitely certain mitzvahs maisis that are not going to apply when Mashiach comes. The Zohar mentions some of them. And like I said, the Rishonim get into this a lot. When is it? And how is it? And what is it? But hakol moedim, that at some point, the activity of the mitzvah is not going to be is necessary anymore. Because all the mitzvahs, the reason for the mitzvahs is the subtle reality, the energetic reality, the spiritual reality that's awoken by the mitzvahs. And when people understand that side of the mitzvahs, then they don't need the physical side to transfer this information anymore. They can understand it in its origin, in its source. That even those that in Perik Chelik, they say that this one doesn't have Chelik L'Olam Habo, that one doesn't have Chelik L'Olam Habo, and these all kinds of different categories and some individuals, but the Dorshei Rishimas, those who understood deeper, said they all come L'Olam Habo. Why? The Olam Habo b'Emes b'Lo Yigvul. Moshem v'Achatich Nachas Yaakov Yichud, it's a Nachle b'Li Mitzorim, it has no limitations. Aval Olam Hazeh Enekein v'Bal Gvul Zman HaMasim Tov V'Ra. This world is not like that, so Chazal couldn't tell you that. So Chazal have to tell you, according to this world and how we see things in this world, that person cannot have a Chalek L'Olam Habo. But according to how we're going to see in L'Olam Habo, we're going to see differently. We should all be Zoyche, Shabbi, Bikor, Bimeinu.